Good evening. I ask you to please sit down. Get comfortable. We're about to begin. Let me welcome you to this symposium. We hope that it'll be very successful. The weather certainly suggests that it'll be a fine event. Just a few little items. Regretfully, the President of Ukraine will not be able to make it, nor will the Prime Minister. Their apologies, the Prime Minister's office suggests that you have the ministers instead, or as well. So we want to thank them for at least keeping their schedule open until the last minute. I'd like to just say a couple of words about how this conference originated. I'd like to thank Yuri Gorodnichenko and Timofey Milovanov as the two people who thought of this conference. They're also co-founders of Vox Ukraine, which I think all of you diligently read. And they are also involved with the Journal of Comparative Economics, which has agreed to issue a separate issue with the papers of this conference, related papers, which is an unprecedented event. We also would like to thank the support that we've received, and the enthusiastic support, I would say, from the United States Agency for International Development, for the Stockholm Institute of Transitional Economics, from the Western NIS Enterprise Fund, from the Association of Comparative Economic Studies, and from the University of California, Berkeley. We have a very illustrious set of panels, the best scholars, professors, bankers, policymakers from the world, from North America, EU, and from Ukraine. Participating in this will also be ministers of Ukrainian ministers of economics, finance, energy, and agriculture, as well as the head of the National Bank of Ukraine. Let me just take a second out to give some perspective to this study. To this conference, rather. This is an unusual situation. This is a country and an economy which has three enormous challenges facing it. Number one, there is a war going on, which is terribly distracting, with an enormous drain of resources, destruction of productive capacity, radical reduction in export earnings, all of which create enormous problems of a recession and devaluation. And then thirdly, an economy and a political system that is attempting to undertake radical reform, long delayed, but finally well underway. I think all of us are hopeful or even optimistic. I know that when I walk through the hallways of the Cabinet of Ministers, I see only young people. I don't see any of the old faces that used to be there, that used to haunt those halls for decades. They're gone. If you see anybody over 50, you sort of stop and stare and wonder, is he going to be in that 50% headcount reduction? And also, what encourages all of us is an extremely active civil society. Remember, some of you may remember that in 1990, there was a civil movement that ousted the Prime Minister Massol and said no to a new union treaty. This was the famous Revolution on the Granite. Revolution was done, people went about their business, they went home. And Ukraine became independent. In 2004, there was a revolution. People did what they had to do, and they went home and trusted the government. This time, I think civil society is awake, aroused, vigilant. It's not sleeping. And I think this is an enormous groundswell of support for the reforms that are underway, and that'll be coming. And reforms, of course, are encountering enormous resistance. They are not coming easily, but I think this time Ukraine will succeed with your help. It'll succeed in resolving these enormous economic problems which it faces. So, without any further ado, I'd like to invite the Governor of the National Bank of Ukraine, Mrs. Hontreva, to tell us what we should do.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, maybe not even ladies and gentlemen, because you are really very young professionals. I'm really very happy to see all of you here. You are really our hopes, and you are a new generation. And you know that Vox Ukraine is a very new platform, but it's already became a respectable professional platform in our country. And because today I'm only one, maybe from governmental part speaker, that's why my speech today will be quite long. Be prepared. And more to that, because I could not join you, unfortunately, tomorrow, I'm absolutely ready to answer all your questions. Okay? So you are ready? Okay. And you know that National Bank, being an avant-garde of reform, I could not even, it's not a shame for me to confirm that right now, really support reform and all advice of all professionals in all other sectors of economy. A meeting like this one today is vital for Ukraine. This meeting provides the opportunity to discuss our reforms and what are now taking place in our country in all fronts. The reform process is complicated, but irreversible. It's very important that it's irreversible, because you know that main idea for all such old people which are sitting right now on this table, it's exactly that all what we do right now in our National Bank, in other maybe part, after it will be irreversible, and for all of you, for all new generation, will join us. When all of you join us, we could be absolutely ready to leave all of that, what we do right now, exactly for you. That's why be ready for all these changes. And that's why I'm absolutely happy that what we are doing, I truly believe that it will be irreversible. Because I truly believe that last year was a really milestone of Ukraine and for Ukraine and for Ukrainian people. And I truly believe that will be no return to all these ages, all these legacies, because we are talking today about post-Soviet legacies. Unfortunately, we lived here more than 20 years in all these post-Soviet legacies. Certainly, it's very difficult to cope with all problems alone, especially under the conditions of military aggression. It's not even military aggression, it's even real war in our country. The support of IMF, World Bank, and other supranationals are extremely important for us today. It's not only in financial terms. IMF and World Bank programs are also a roadmap of reform in Ukraine. As a head of delegation, Ukrainian delegation, I have participated in IMF and World Bank spring meeting in Washington last week. We met all delegations of IMF, we met all delegation of World Bank. We met Christine Lagarde. Of course, we participated in all official events of spring meetings. And I can tell you that everybody confirms that they observe and see the real movement in the of our reforms in the right direction. That's why I'm absolutely glad to tell you that we're on the right track. And right now, all international community really recognized our movement to this direction. Today's support of foreign investment community is absolutely essential for us. It's not only investment in cash form, but it's modern technology, it's all best practices in corporate governance. We perfectly understand that macro stability is a must for any investments in our country. And the second essential point is protection of investments' rights. And all this, all of that definitely right now in our reform progress in our reform in banking sector, and I am elaborate about that later on. Indeed, comprehensive reform are the key prerequisite for Ukraine to cope with all the challenges, to balance economic position and restore growth. Today, it is a top priority for both National Bank and for the government of Ukraine. All of that, really a top priority for all of us. And now I'd like, of course, to focus on central bank agenda and what we are doing now. First of all, we are reforming the monetary policy. Second, we implement new market instruments and new market infrastructure. The third one, we are strengthening our banking sector and enhancing the banking supervision. And of course, we're improving legislation and intensifying control over its compliance. Because you know, in our country, only to adopt legislation, it's the only first, and I can tell you, maybe the minimal step what should be done. Because comply with this regulation, really comply not only from the National Bank point of view or from the Ministry of Finance point of view, but first of all for our court system point of view. And all of you know about that. But of course, National Bank could only prepare changes in legislation and, of course, to support all these changes and support all these changes in our parliament. And, of course, the fifth one and the very important also for the central bank, and we are really reforming ourselves inside. Let me elaborate about all of that. First of all, it's a monetary policy. You know about our changes maybe in monetary policy. You already see recently that one of your colleagues, it's also expert of Vox Ukraine, joined our team in the capacity of deputy governor of the National Bank. It's Dmitry Sologub, and he is responsible for monetary for our monetary policy division. And he joined us like expert even half a year ago, but recently, because he helped us to set up this absolutely right platform for our monetary policy, he became our deputy governor. The main aim of our monetary policy it's in midterm horizon, it's a low, it's of course stability, it's a low and stable inflation. And all this low and stable inflation we'd like to achieve within a flexible exchange rate. That will allow our economy to keep competitiveness and National Bank to steady accumulate our foreign currency reserves. I'd like to tell you about our foreign currency reserves. You know what's happened with our foreign currency reserves, all of you professionals. And you see that in February, our currency reserves reach absolutely incredibly low level. And only because of all our international support from IMF and World Bank, right now our reserves already equal to 10 billion US dollars, and to the end of this year, our aim right now to reach 18 billion US dollars. And in 4-year horizon, we'd like to reach 38 billion US dollars. And of course, I'd like to tell you, like a governor of the National Bank, for me, gross reserves, of course, it's a very good picture for everybody, for market, for confidence, and for all international community. But like governor of the National Bank, I'd like to see our net reserves, our real growth of our net reserves. Because to change one creditor, like a public sector, from other supranational creditors, it's not a main aim of our country. Because only we need it only for now, you know, especially for this transition period to achieve all our aims. And that's why right now we're we start all our direction in the absolutely right direction, our trends in right direction, because I can tell you it's not even yet public information that National Bank already accumulated some money into our net reserves, because we start to buy even currency right now, because right now we have a more or less stable situation during 2 months in our market, forex market. Also, the next step, of course, steady accumulation of our foreign currency reserves. Now we are in a preparation stage of inflation targeting, but some prerequisites for that should be reached in our country. Some prerequisites, of course, it's more or less balanced budget, and it's more or less developed forex and money market in our country. And I truly believe that we're on the right track and we will reach all these prerequisites. It's already envisaged in our EFF program, and I truly believe that in 1.5 or maybe 2 years we will reach all these prerequisites and we will be ready for inflation targeting, implementation of inflation targeting. What we are doing right now in 2015, because inflation targeting is still in a two-year horizon. First of all, our monetary policy this year is formulated consistent with inflation objectives based on the monetary aggregates regime. And also, and the National Bank will use net international reserves and net domestic assets as operational targets and based money for intermediate target, and rely on open market operations to achieve them. I indicated you some parameters, and all these parameters already in our EFF programs. That's why you can easily observe all of them and how we comply with all of these criteria in our EFF program. We consider the goal to get single-digit inflation in the medium run as achievable. Shrinking domestic demand and combination of prudent fiscal and monetary policy and elimination of ineffective energy subsidies will stabilize inflation dynamics. The optimal level of inflation is estimated to be 5% in the horizon of 3 or 5 years. It still right now for you looks like absolutely not realistic, because you know what's happened in our country right now. You know the year-to-year inflation today reached incredible high 45%. You know that last month in March, inflation hit the highest inflation rate per month since 1995. It's 10.8%, absolutely incredible. And nobody, believe me, even predicted that it could be such a hike. And it's happened because of instability in our foreign exchange market and panic of our population. You remember when it's happened even in Ukrainian supermarket, when not only for some imported goods, some absolutely panic appeared, and or just even for absolutely simple product like sugar, which locally produced here in Ukraine. And right now we face such a high level of inflation. And this month, you know that from the beginning of April, the tariffs will be increased drastically. And even gas prices will be increased by 300%. That's why, you know, that implications we will see of all this increase of our regulated tariffs. And this year, that's why unfortunately this year we are only talking with you how to stop core inflation, because all these regulatory tariffs inflation, you know, we need to somehow live with that. Because all these disbalances which were created in our country during the last 20 years, it's time for us really to clean up all this mess in our energy tariffs. That's why it's absolutely acceptable, and it's very painful, but acceptable for all of us. But of course, National Bank should fight with high core inflation. And it's one of our main targets right now. When we are talking about 5% target for the in 3 or 5 years, I think it's achievable. And because right now in these 3 years, I truly believe that all these disbalances will be eliminated, and we will be ready for inflation targeting, as I mentioned to you before. And since the beginning of 2015, National Bank operational framework to conduct monetary policy has significantly changed. The procedure of accumulation and keeping the required reserves by banks has been streamlined through the unification of the reserve requirements. And so first of all, it's only reserve requirements for banks. That's why I indicated it's in our monetary policy. The second one, what National Bank did to strengthen this position in monetary policy, it's role of the National Bank discount rate as a key policy rate, and this role really strengthened, and right now we're really seeing that in one day in our country, our key rate will be not anymore like fairy tale. You know what's happened in our country when key rate was 7%, and was absolutely not reality. And unfortunately, right now, to stop very high panic in the foreign exchange market and absolutely incredible development in inflation, we introduce a very high interest rate. Right now, nothing to be proud of, because our interest rate, key interest rate, reached 30%, that maybe right now it's absolutely highest rate, key rate of central banks in the world. But of course, it's you all professionals, and you understand what we are doing. That you already have seen what's happened in our foreign exchange market, how we stop all this negative development. That's why I'd like to repeat again that this year we already, first of all, we increase our key rate this year from 14 to 19.5%. It was not this year, it was end of last year, but from 4th of March this year, to stop all this panic and stop this negative inflation development, we increase our rate from 19.5% to 30% per annum. What we did else? We introduced very tough, I can tell you, even draconic administrative measures. All these draconic administrative measures are still in place. And but what we finally achieved. The foreign exchange market is more or less stable during the last 2 months, but risk of inflation and depreciation model unfortunately remain high. In order to avoid the realization of this risk and ensure a firm downward path in inflation, the National Bank continue the policy of so-called expensive money by keeping the interest rate high. I can tell you that yesterday we have our monetary policy committee, and monetary policy committee decided to keep this rate for additional 1 month, because we already observed some stability in Forex, and I will right now tell you more. When exchange rate markets show further signs of stabilization and inflation expectations become truly anchored, the National Bank of Ukraine will be able to start a gradual easing of monetary conditions both in, by lowering the key rate and abolishing administrative restrictions. It's exactly what I'm talking about, because as soon as we see that market is will be in stabilization mode, we immediately ease our administrative restrictions and also start to decrease gradually again our key rate. Also, the ability to ease monetary policy is largely depends on the successful implementation of structural reform, fiscal consolidation, and restoring the soundness of the banking system, which make up the fundamentals for exchange rate stabilization. I'd like to repeat you again that you know that National Bank not produce balance of payment of our country. National Bank is a just regulator. And of course, we have quite limited instrument to stabilize the situation if nothing in fundamentals will change. That's why National Bank can only introduce some administrative measures, do some verbal intervention, or do some money intervention, or increase or decrease our key rate. Unfortunately, our key rate, it's only in the beginning instrument of development, because unfortunately, it still have quite limited impact on market, but in few years, believe me, we will be like in developed countries, it will really, do some leading role in our monetary policy. Also, very often Question from you: should the central bank manage the exchange rate float? How long should capital control be in place? It's even your experts asked me to answer this question in my today's speech. First of all, I'd like to mention that National Bank is a central bank right now, central bank of the country in war. More to that, Ukraine is open economy with disproportionately high accumulated disbalances practically in all sectors of economy, in gas, energy, public sector, etc. Open economy also, we have open economy both, also in both sides, from export point of view and from import point of view. We still have no import substitution program and inflation, where this pass-through effect from devaluation is crucially depend on exchange rate. We believe that managing extreme fluctuation on flexible exchange rate will allow us to keep core inflation under control. We do not consider returning to currency peg regime. Ukraine just couldn't afford this. I'd like to elaborate a little more about that. You know that even to switch from a peg regime and to flexible currency regime, we are not still talking about freely convertible hryvnia, believe me. We are talking only about flexible foreign exchange rate. And even switch from when your country live 23 years really pegged to US dollar, and when this US dollar peg was even like a saint call for all Ukrainian population, to switch from this regime to the flexible one could be really painful even without all this war. Because all these devils which happened last year, it's only a trigger of tons of accumulated disbalances in our country. Even without any war with Russia, without any annexion of Crimea, you know, we could face absolutely the same result, only maybe not last year, but in few years later on. That's why all these devils already happened, and we should, I could not should tell you, should tell in thanks to anybody, because for this war, it's absolutely awful what's going on in our eastern part, and all this, with all this annexion of Crimea. But I'd like to reassure you that all of that which we face right now with our inflation, deregulation, which our, with our exchange rate could happen in with us anywhere. Anyway, that's why you know, it's already happened, and right now for us it's main idea to really utilize all these possibilities which this absolutely incredible devaluation of our country gave to our export, to our import, because to our export it's exactly the, a very good benefit for all our export, but for our import it's absolutely time to start import substitution programs in our country. And that's why I'd like to repeat again, we're committed to flexible exchange rate, and believe me, it's even impossible for anybody else. And I'd like all of you, like professionals, will also explain, try to explain all of that to all other experts, that no point of return to the peg rate of hryvnia. And I already mentioned that right now we try to minimize this absolutely not fundamental movement of rate, but some absolutely high fluctuations. You know why all these fluctuations happened and this absolutely incredible volatility, only because during the wartime it's very difficult to try to find any equilibrium. That's why National Bank introduced all these draconic administrative measures. Because, you know, when some panic appeared, it's appeared not only among population in the street, it's unfortunately appeared also in all these business circles, and you know about that. And that's why National Bank right now keeps situation under control. We very actively participate in the market because unfortunately our foreign exchange market still have very limited depths, but we truly believe that we will achieve this very soon. Capital control are unpleasant but essential measure for emerging markets economy and unavoidable, especially when country in the military conflict. Resolution of major fiscal imbalances, resolution of macroeconomic stability are prerequisites of ease capital controls. After the stabilization of economy, we may need to manage inflows, and capital that run from abroad need to meet the proper capacity of financial system and economic to absorb it. Yes, very good phrase, because we already start to worry that capital inflow will very heavily go into Ukraine, and it's a very good sign. And about macroeconomic forecast, you also asked me to update you about macroeconomic forecast. I already mentioned you inflation. You know, we changed our inflation forecast 3 times this year. It's again, I can tell you it's nothing to be proud of, but in the same time, what we can do when such absolutely incredible situation in our country. And that's why our economic forecast, our forecast for inflation, it's 30% to the end of this year. Even when right now we see that it's already year to year, it's 45, but right now only April, and you know how we calculate the inflation to the end of this year. About 10% of this inflation of this 30% will be attributed to increase of our regulated tariffs. And inflation, as I already mentioned, that inflation will peak in the first half of 2015 due to hryvnia depreciation and utility tariffs adjustment. In the same time, inflation will be contained by low consumer demand and decline in global commodity prices. That's why to the end of this year, from today's 45%, we believe that it will be 30. Started from Q2, we expect a gradual recovery in economic activity. Primary positive to contribution of net export and capacity utilization. Some rebound in consumer and investment demand is expected to start from the second half of 2015. You know that in our EFF program, you've seen the forecast for GDP was 5.5. You can tell us that we only agreed these parameters in the end of February this year. But in the same time, right now, National Bank already changed our forecast, and GDP, according to our forecast, will be negative, like minus 7.5. And all this 7.5, unfortunately, it's attributed, and why we change our forecast, because the first 2 months, January and February, were absolutely negative. It was drop in industrial output more than 20%, 21.8%. It was a drop of industrial output. That's why, unfortunately, we change our forecast. But we truly believe that right now our economy reached already the lowest point. We really reach the bottom, and we truly believe that we start our growth starting from the second half of this year. And also we truly believe that the same stable situation will be with our foreign exchange policy and with our inflation. And the economic growth projected for 2013 is plus 3%. And current account deficit for this year, initially we think even that it will be balanced, but unfortunately after the figure of January, February, we can tell you that it will be slightly negative. But slightly negative means it's like in our country, it's like a deviation, because you know that when we started, ended 2013 with current account deficit like 10%, and when we are now talking that in this year it will be like 1% only, I think it could be like a deviation. That's why it will be a quite small current account deficit. And but we will have surplus in our financial account in 2015 and 2013, and it will be achieved due to substantial amount of official external financing and the expected restructuring of sovereign and quasi-sovereign debt. You know that our restructuring right now in place. And I truly believe that we will reach agreement with all our creditors, because when I met all investors in Washington last week, and all of that asked me about, you know, because for them all this restructuring, it's a quite painful process. Everybody, of course, are absolutely happy that it's only for public debt. It's not for, for example, for the debt of state banks. For state banks, it's only extension of maturity required by our program and nothing more. But for sovereign right now, our program envisages three parameters. It's some haircut of principal amount, some extension of maturity, and some possibility to decrease of coupon. That's why I truly believe that our Minister of Finance spent about 2 weeks right now in meetings with investors, and we truly believe that it's achievable. Of course, nobody knows yet what kind of haircut, but I know that investors understand our problem right now. And together with IMF financing and all other international support, we will restore our international reserves. And as I mentioned you already, and I will repeat, we will reach $18 billion reserves, which will cover more than 3 months of our imports. The major risk of our forecast, of course, is the escalation of the military conflict in the East. And this escalation could may cause further capital outflow from the country, deeper hryvnia depreciation, and another maybe peak of inflation. But in our base scenario, we still believe that our Minsk II agreement, ceasefire agreement, will be in place. We still believe that some peaceful resolution will be achieved. That's why our base scenario is not envisaged any violation of our Minsk II agreement. And of course, what we do else, we improve really our communications, and our deputy governor, Dmitry Sologub, is sitting here, and today I can tell you that I got from international community very good notes that we incredibly increase our policy making communication, and thanks to Dmitry for he joined our team, and right now I got very good appreciation from international investors about all of that. And we created, first of all, monetary policy committee, and as I already told you, each month, right now, in one day, you will also be sitting and waiting on your screens of Reuters and Bloomberg announcement of our monetary policy committee. I hope for that. And also what we created else, we created very important platform. We created Financial Stability Board. Financial Stability Board, Governor of the National Bank and Minister of Finance are co-chair this Financial Stability Board. And also the member of this Financial Stability Board, it's head of our Security Exchange Commission, head of our DGF Fund, Deposit Guarantee Fund, and also head of Non-Banking Financial Institution Commission. That's why on Monday next week we will have our first official meeting, but unofficial meetings before we had only with our Minister of Finance, and of course, like one team of economic reform platform, we do these meetings very often and discuss all our problems. But with in such a community and officially Financial Stability Board first meeting will be next week. Now a few words about Ukrainian banking system reform and our key achievements. What I can tell you, if some of our colleagues only start the reform, I can tell you that we're already in a finishing stage on the first maybe part of our banking sector reform, because the first part of our banking system reform call cleanup exercise. And right now I will tell you about this cleanup exercise. And first of all, why we need to clean up our banking system? Why we not pretend again that everything was more or less okay with our banking system. You know, when we are talking about this post-Soviet legacy, I can tell you that last year when we did the stress test of Ukrainian banking system, we were not surprised, but we confirm absolutely understandable idea that unfortunately Ukrainian banking system was not clean up from the legacy of the crisis, 2008 crisis, when all other banking systems around the world were already cleaned up. And of course, what we did. Since 2014, 47 banks have been already withdrawn from the market. We sent all these 47 banks, including some big banks, you know, to our DGF fund. And 14 of them were declared insolvent since the beginning of 2015. And all of that we need really to resolve inefficient banks and banks violating the money laundering law. I can tell you that among these 47 banks, biggest part of them were never been even, could not even name banks. It was absolutely money laundering machine in our countries. And even when our country, you know, joined this FATF agreement 10 years ago and when withdraw from this black list of money laundering countries, unfortunately, all these banks were only a money laundering machine. It was absolutely incredible turnover of money in money laundering in our country, unfortunately. And you've seen and you remember all this criticism what National Bank got last year, and you know why? Because we started our reforms in June and July last year. And when during the meeting of our reform platform, I told already to all my colleagues from government, it was in the beginning of this year, I told them that, guys, I will recognize that you started reform when all negative press will be yours. And I will present you all this crown of leadership in this particular field. Because last year, 99% of National Bank remarks in the press was negative. And about National Bank, maybe only 90%. But about me personally was negative 99%. And because we are not a politicians, we are pure technocrats, you know, it was very painful, but, you know, it's not killing us. It's only, we only became maybe stronger because of that. And I also like to tell to all my colleagues from government that they should also be strong, because right now when we start reform in energy sector, in transportation sector, in tech sector, all of them, believe me, it will be very painful for all of them. And that's why I can now tell you that 25% of Ukrainian banking system disappear, but not regret. Please, do not be regretful about that, because it were absolutely zombie banks. These banks have absolutely no assets at all. They attracted money from market, but assets, it's absolutely zero assets there. And also, I can tell you that we stopped already and we will really clean up Ukrainian banking system from so-called oligarch model of Ukrainian banking system. Because, you know, some banks in our country were not again a bank, but it was only a machine how to siphon all money from depositors to finance your own business. That's why related lending and related party transactions were absolutely incredible. In some banks, believe me, it reached about 90% of the assets of these banks. And that's why we really will see healthy banking system very soon, I hope. Also, what we did else? We introduced the following measures to stabilize the banking system. First of all, we increase requirement of new banks. Right now, they need a new capital like 500 million hryvnia. You know, that's why no one bank even ask us right now to, no one shareholders ask us right now to establish the new bank, because it's a quite sizable amount, 500 for the capital, more to that. If you observe the capital of some Ukrainian banks that time, you can recognize that this money, even minimal capital like 120 million, were never exist at all. It was only some so-called different type of schemes, different type of securities, which was absolutely garbage, not even, it's impossible even to call them, you know, securities. And it was that's why right now you should you have possibility only to open the bank to pay 500 million fresh capital and only in money and real money, not through different type of schemes. We also increase and all banks with minimal capital of 120 million right now will be obliged to increase their capital to 500 million. And that's why we truly believe that some consolidation of sector will exist. We improve the procedure of removing banks from the market, and also M&A and P&A procedure. P&A is maybe banking term, and it's purchase at assumption. It's with in banking sector. It's very it's more even interesting transactions than M&A. And also we improve all these procedures for all these M&A and P&A transactions. We also introduced strict procedure for disclosure of beneficial owner of banks, and recently maybe you've seen that some banks, even very reputable banks, were penalized for not to disclose of non-disclosure of their shareholders. And what we did very crucial, it was a prior action in our EFF program. And our parliament supported this prior action. Our parliament already voted for very important and crucial law. It's a law of to increase responsibilities of management and owners of bank for all the, for manipulations, for all these wrongdoings. And I think it's absolutely significant movement, and of course right now ball in the territory of our court system, because we do our best in this particular field. And when will this cleanup exercise will be finished? We have already completed the major part of this exercise. In 2 months, I hope we will announce that first stage of banking system reform is completed. Bankruptcies of smaller banks might follow, but it will not have a significant impact on the system after that. The NBU has started the diagnostic study of the banks to identify their needs in additional capitalization. I can tell you that when we clean up Ukrainian banks and when we did the stress test of last year, it was only stress test, like an asset quality review of 2013. And that's why it was a legacy of previous years. All our stress tests, it could not be even called stress test last year, because what happened in reality, all these devils which happened with devaluation, with annexion of Crimea, with the war in the eastern part, we could not even compare with that the parameters of stress test which we already implemented. That's why unfortunately all devils happened last year with even for all our healthy banking sector. And that's why we agreed already with IMF that we already designed a special program for all our healthy banks. All of them will be recapitalized not in one shot, but during next 4 years. To the end of this year, these banks will show their regulatory capital only like if reach regulatory capital is 4%, and tier one capital is regulatory capital is 5%, and tier one capital is 4%, and only in 4 year times they reach the regulatory capital like 10%. Because initially, you know that our official 10-year percent of our solvency ratio, it will be introduced and banks will reach in 4 years. For related party transaction, understanding how huge related party transaction in our banking system, we also, together with IMF, developed a special program and together with World Bank. Because World Bank is very actively involved in our reforming of our financial sector. We elaborate the special program for related party transaction. All of them will be recognized this year. And next, it will be special schedule how reduce to the normal level of this related party transaction in 3 years. That's why recapitalization in 4 years and related party transaction in 3 years. But the main idea is, you know, it will be absolutely trend to increase capital and trend to decrease all these related parties. That's why I think it's absolutely, it's crucial for us. And after stabilization, the administrative restrictions in the forex market and restriction of withdrawal of deposits will be gradually removed. And right now, I can tell you the seventh laws already we presented to parliaments, including the strengthening of NBU independence law and creditors protection law. Two of them, it's absolutely crucial for our further reforms and for our movement. And what we will do in 2 months, I assume that we will announce so-called matrix reloaded, means that it's time for us to start new banking system. But without permanent proper supervision from the central bank, it unfortunately will not work. That's why we already started in June last year and full transformation of national bank to our to absolutely new organization. And first of all, what we did. This reform, we streamline all our, we change all our processes. We streamline off all our organizational charts. We already start to sell all our non-core assets and to transfer all our not core activities to other organizations. For example, our universities will be transferred to the Ministry of Education, and we recently also transfer our television to new Ministry of Media Relations. And also, we evaluate all our processes. What we did, we already announced the plan to cut 50% of our personnel. We will reach this 50% cut to the end of this year. We already cut our expenditures from 11 billion hryvnia to 5 billion hryvnia. It was even our initial budget for this year, which was elaborated in September last year. And we already hired very professional management team. And I think you will see the difference very soon. And also, maybe I'd like to give floor to my colleagues, of course, but the last few items, it's about our complex program of financial sector reforms. Because right now, banking sector in Ukraine represents about 85% of our financial sector. And right now, it will be the real reform of financial sector. It's not time, maybe, because some idea was about mega regulator. And we still decided that maybe it's not a good idea for National Bank, because we need to, first of all, to clean up banking sector. But still, we discuss and create one particular platform, and National Bank right now in the driving seat of financial sector reform, and because we're also responsible and for implementation of financial sector reform in our National Council of Reform. And our program of reform and our strategic program right now in our website, you can see what we are going to achieve. And of course, first of all, it's financial stability, because you know that we can clean up banking sector, but without macro stability, all this exercise will not work at all. That's why financial and macro stability, it's a first. And development, of course, of financial instruments, development of institutional capacity of financial market regulators, and of course, first of all, it's consumer and financial investor protection rights, because without this, we will not see any investment. But to achieve all of that, first of all, we need from all of you, from all population of Ukraine, we need to stop the war. And if I truly believe that when we stop the war, our reform will be implemented. Thank you.
Thank you very much for an unexpectedly thorough, detailed description, analysis, and plans. We really appreciate that very much. Thank you.
Ready to answer questions, but after our colleagues, okay.
I think that's fair, yes. Ambassador Pyatt, perhaps you would say a word to us. Yeah.
Good. Well, first of all, thank you, George, for the invitation. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here. I'd also like to thank Vox Ukraine. Special acknowledgement to UC Berkeley. As a graduate of the University of California system, it's always nice to find a connection with my past. I appreciate especially those of you who've come a long way to be here, including, of course, my brilliant predecessor, John Herbst. And if he had done a better job while he was here, we wouldn't be here today. But this is a well-timed event and is an important companion event to the International Support for Ukraine conference that will take place on Tuesday. And I hope will provide an occasion for 2 days of really deep dive into the full range of reform efforts that are taking place in Ukraine today. I think you heard from Governor Hunter-Reva a clear description of what's happening in the financial sector. And if you doubt that there is an urgent requirement to do a better job of telling the story of what's happening here, I would encourage you to read today's front page Wall Street Journal story, looking ahead to the important EU summit meeting on Monday, and the characterization, the mischaracterization in that report regarding some of the really significant progress that's happened here. As US ambassador to Ukraine, one of my goals is helping my leadership in Washington to understand the truly transformational moment that Ukraine is experiencing. And this conference and the special issue of the Journal of Comparative Economics that will result, I hope will help the world's academic community to understand better what has transpired here over the past year and a half. The other part of my job, of course, is to speak frankly about the work that is still to be done. And I will do that as well later in these remarks. But first, a couple of words about where I believe Ukraine is today. This is a country that is fighting a war on three fronts. The first battle is a military one against Russian-led and Russian-supplied forces in the east. It's being fought with tanks, artillery, and rocket launchers that are sent from Russia. As a result of this Russian-manufactured war, more than 6,000 people are dead. Over 1 million people have fled the violence and need to be fed, housed, given jobs, and integrated into new communities. The second is a war for the truth, a fight against the lies and misrepresentations that are coming from the Kremlin. Moscow's propaganda machine drowns the truth with made-up tales of death, torture, and fascism. Russia's goal is to confuse, demoralize, and distract not only Ukraine from the important reform project that is underway, but Europe and the United States as well. By doing so, the Kremlin hopes to prevent the people of Ukraine from living the life they choose with the government they choose, and to build the European state they want. The third is a war to modernize Ukraine's political system and economy, to root out corruption. I use the war imagery in this instance deliberately to underscore the seriousness of the challenges ahead. As I have said on many occasions, corruption, business as usual, are as much a threat to Ukraine today as Russian tanks. Ukraine's political leaders know they must carry out difficult reforms and live up to the expectations of the Maidan for justice and rule of law. They must do so while laying the foundations of a strong and sustainable European democracy. In managing expectations, we need to be clear on two points. These reforms will be hard, and they will not be quick. A major focus of this symposium, of course, is the work of economic reform that needs to be done. If there is one constant in Ukraine's post-independence history, it's unfulfilled economic potential. And I can assure you that Ambassador Herbst, and indeed all of my predecessors, gave me long talks before I came out to Ukraine 2 years ago about how I would get to the point where I would be speaking about unfulfilled potential. But it's absolutely true. With its land, minerals, and human resources, Ukraine should be a very rich country. But the Ukrainian government recognizes that if it's to achieve this goal and unlock this wealth, it must empower its private sector. To do so, Ukraine's leaders have undertaken an ambitious program to change how business gets done. They're simplifying the tax code, they're battling the culture of corruption that saps money, resources, and public trust. In this regard, I applaud the recent appointment of Artem Sitnik as the new head of the National Anti-Corruption Bureau. This is a tremendous and important first step, but it is only a first step. Now we look for the government to empower the Bureau, to provide the Bureau with the independent and competent team that it needs to take on the important tasks ahead. My government, to include the FBI, the Department of Justice, the Department of State, is ready to help. The U.S. Department of Justice and the FBI are actively supporting the Anti-Corruption Bureau and the Prosecutor's Office. We're providing short-term advisors to make sure that the Bureau has the tools it needs to investigate and stop corruption and to facilitate a strong relationship between the Bureau and the Prosecutor's Office that will continue to play a critical role. The U.S. government is also working with the Ministry of Interior to support Ukraine's new patrol police. The ministry aims to create a Western model force to replace the unpopular and universally corrupt traffic police. This is the Ministry of Interior's top reform priority, and it's a direct answer to the demands of the Maidan and the people of Ukraine. It is clear to me that Ukrainians are ready for change. More than 11,000 Kyiv residents, including 3,000 women, applied for jobs with the new patrol police. Today, professionals from the California Highway Patrol are working to train the patrol police according to U.S. standards and best practices. And on Monday, Minister Avakov launched recruitment for a parallel program in Lviv. As you will hear over the coming days, the government of Ukraine is making tangible progress in implementing reforms that focus on improving the business environment and eliminating opportunities for corruption. This includes the regulatory reform that is being carried out by the Ministry of Economic Development and Trade to reduce unnecessary bureaucratic procedures. A critical parallel effort, however, is promoting greater transparency. For instance, the Ministry of Infrastructure now requiring online streaming of tenders involving state enterprises. Plans to further simplify the tax code will make this country a better place to invest and do business, but also reduce opportunities for graft. Ukraine's reform-minded government is also committed to reducing the influence of oligarchs in business. President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk have demonstrated that they reject the law of the jungle and insist that backroom deals that further enrich Ukraine's wealthiest at the expense of the nation will no longer be tolerated. No one should be above the law. This will be difficult, but to the extent Ukraine sticks firmly to the path of reform, the United States, and I believe our European partners, and Ambassador Tembinski will speak to this, will be with you. Through the IMF, we are contributing $17.5 billion for a four-year program to support Ukraine's reform efforts. I look forward to soon signing our second $1 billion loan guarantee agreement since May 2014, which is intended to help Ukraine regain its financial footing. We expect to provide an additional $1 billion in 2015, contingent on further progress on reforms. Along with other partners in the international community, we're also providing expertise and advice. American advisors are working alongside the Ukrainian government counterparts in helping to bring about the kind of changes to processes and regulations that the business community so desperately desires. Ukraine's leadership has made great progress. Let there be no mistake of that. But much remains to be done. In particular, the government needs to go further to root out corruption and allow Ukrainians to make an honest living. We will continue to work together to strengthen Ukraine's criminal justice system and to create a more efficient and clean energy sector. But to succeed, Ukraine also needs a strong foundation of constitutional reforms and decentralization that make more citizens and ensure that the taxes are in the people's best interests. The goal is for individual citizens and their chosen leaders to make many of the decisions that directly affect their lives and livelihoods. Local authorities best understand the needs of their communities, and putting more tax revenue and decision-making power at that level meets European standards, as local leaders can respond more efficiently to needs for government services and for jobs. Decentralization can and should strengthen Ukraine's democracy and complete the process of building a new country that began on the Maidan. By incorporating the views of more people into local decision-making around the country, decentralization can be a powerful tool for countering Russian-generated separatist movements in the East. Decentralization can strengthen Ukraine's economy by providing opportunities for local governments to have a stronger influence on their tax base. To protect tax revenues, mayors and city councils will have more sway over local budgets. This decentralization reform has just begun. Fiscal decentralization was passed by the Rada in December to deliver $1 revenue to local budgets, increasing the funding for education and health care. The United States will continue to support these reform efforts as communities begin the hard work of consolidating and rearranging services. Specifically, the U.S. government will provide financial support and technical assistance to the Ministry of Regional Development to implement key reforms in consolidating communities through the local government reform and implementation support offices. Getting this done is important so that people know who they will be voting for in municipal elections in October. But of course, we understand that real reform cannot happen overnight, and it's not only top-down. It's a long-term process that will take commitment, patience, and honest assessments from government leaders about what they are doing, how much it costs, and how long it will take. It requires honesty from citizens about what they expect and what they are willing to do to help. And it will need support from Ukraine's partners around the world, including the United States. History offers many examples of how to manage such change, but Prime Minister Yatsenyuk and Rada Chairman Groysman are looking in particular to Poland, whose experience offers a valuable roadmap for Ukraine. And I'm reluctant to say anything about this sitting next to Ambassador Tumbinski, and I will let him speak at length on it. But I would just note that today Poland is a country that is divided into 16 regions, 379 counties, and 2,479 municipalities, each with its own government. How did they successfully consolidate local communities and empower local and regional councils to govern effectively? That is the question for the year ahead. Next year, Ukraine will have been independent for 25 years. A generation of Ukrainians has been born and grown into adulthood. Yet reforms that are needed for this country to prosper are only now being put into place. This is Ukraine's moment. Facing the simultaneous challenges of a Russian invasion, an economic crisis inherited from the Yanukovych regime, and a humanitarian crisis with millions of internally displaced persons, Ukraine's population is willing to support their leaders, but is impatient for results. There is a sense that the country has passed the inflection point, that Ukraine has paid a price that is too high in terms of combat deaths, in homes and families destroyed, and is so high now that failure is not an option. But we must remember, as we gather today in Kyiv amid a war on multiple fronts, fighting for Ukraine's future, that these issues are for Ukrainians only to decide. No one outside of Ukraine has any right to make a decision about the path that Ukraine will choose. Only Ukrainians can decide what the future of a sovereign, democratic, and independent Ukraine will be. And it is explicitly not for Russia to dictate how Ukrainians should govern themselves or where your strategic future should lie. I am confident that Ukraine will keep moving forward. The United States will be with you today and in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Pyatt. Ambassador from Baghdad, would you kindly address this?
Thank you, George, and thank you so much for inviting me. I'm extremely honored to be part of such a distinguished panel and speaking in front of such a distinguished audience. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Kyiv School of Economics and the other organizing for having managed to put together such an interesting and relevant program with so many high-level speakers as well. I do think it's a brilliant idea to bring together policymakers, decision makers with academic community. And for those of you that are visiting Kyiv for the first time, I can only congratulate you to coming to one of Europe's most beautiful cities during the warmest weekend so far this year. And I do think that you will find these discussions extremely interesting, because to my mind, when you talk about European security, democratization, economic integration, there is no better place to discuss this than Kyiv. I will start to be slightly bold and perhaps slightly foolish to comment on the title of the conference. The title is Ukraine, Escape from Post-Soviet Legacy? I think it's time that we change the question mark into an exclamation mark. I think my American colleague and EU ambassador would agree with me that having witnessed the changes taking place here the last 2 years, the events unfolding, there is no doubt in our mind that the changes are irreversible. The governor spoke about irreversible reforms. I believe that it's even more important than that. I think the mindset, the changes in the mindset in Ukraine is irreversible. I'm not trying to be naive when it comes to the challenges that lies before the country, but my point is that the end goal to build a democratic, reformed European country based on human rights and rule of law, that end goal will not change. And there are three basic reasons why I am so convinced that these changes are irreversible. First of all, and you will hear this many times, but it's worth repeating many times, that is the dynamic and vibrant civil society in Ukraine. I think that is probably the biggest difference today compared to after the Orange Revolution, and that is that the civil society has matured, developed so much during the last 10 years. And what's unique about the civil society in Ukraine is that it doesn't only play the role of a watchdog and monitoring, it is also a driver for change. And I think the umbrella organization, the reanimation package for reform, is something quite unique. It gathers about 300 experts, lawyers, journalists, together with 70 NGOs. They discuss draft laws, they present them, lobby for them, and also monitor the implementation. And about 30 of the most important laws we have seen throughout the last year has been instigated by the renovation package of reform. But it's more than these NGOs working with reforms. many of the most active, and I did say most progressive deputies in the Verkhovna Rada comes from the civil society and has a background as journalists. Many of them are young women, and I hope and do believe that many of them will be the leaders of this country tomorrow. And when you talk to them and you feel the energy, the urge to change the country, it's very difficult to see how these changes could not be reversible. But the dynamic and strong civil society is more than these NGOs. It's also the whole spirit of volunteerism. The fact that we have the mind-boggling 1.2 million internally displaced people in this country, in the middle of Europe. The support for these people is so much based on volunteerism, on people with their own hardships and fears, still sharing and caring to their fellow compatriots. And I think that is worth our deepest respect. I'm proud to say that out of the Swedish reform support for Ukraine, approximately 25 million euros a year, last year we spent 5 million euros investing in the strong civil society of Ukraine. And I do think that was one of our best investments ever when it comes to supporting Ukraine's reform agenda. The second reason why I think these changes are irreversible is the young generation. As an ambassador in Kyiv, I try at least once a month to go out and meet with young students in universities. And it's like drinking a quadruple espresso. You feel so invigorated afterwards and so full of hope and optimism for this country. And it's abundantly clear when I speak to students, not only in Kyiv, but all over the country, that the vast majority of the young generation see no alternative to comprehensive reform and European integration. I have to tell you about the story yesterday. Yesterday I had the honor to hand out a prize and a nominee for the Stockholm Junior Water Prize. It's a competition we organize globally where young people from age 15 to 18 can compete and present research and inventions that aims to improving the environment and more specifically clearing water, making water more pure and clean. The Ukrainian winner who is going to represent Ukraine in Stockholm in end of July, he had built a boat on his own, a boat robot with which you could measure radiation in water. And it could also print maps that could target exactly and pinpoint exactly where the radiation was and how strong the radiation was. This guy was 17. The most remarkable thing about this guy was that he came from Lugansk. And he had left Lugansk. I'm getting a goosebump also when I'm talking about this. he had left Lugansk last summer, fleeing the conflict and the Russian aggression. And although he had traveled around Ukraine and finally ended up in Kyiv, he still had the commitment, determination to also build this robot and win this astonishing prize. And with a commitment like that among the young generation, it's very difficult not to be an optimist about this country. The third reason why I think these changes are irreversible, sort of a tragic irony, and that is actually the Russian aggression that we have seen. I think there's no secret to most of us that there are those in Moscow who view a successful, prosperous, reformed Ukraine as a threat. And the fact that Russia has illegally annexed Crimea, has carried the responsibility for their aggressions in eastern Ukraine. It's an irony that these aggressions, to my mind, has actually helped to galvanize the Ukrainian people. If you look at the opinion polls, it's remarkable support for membership has grown the last years. And the customs union, last time I saw, was about 10%. Even though I have to add that I don't think that Ukrainians view this as a geopolitical issue, whether or not go east or west. I think most Ukrainians realize it's whether you go up or down. It's about what kind of society you want to build. If you want to build a society built on rules, rule of law, democracy, respect for human rights, or if you want to go back to the past. And there, I think, to my mind, that the decision has been made and it's an irreversible decision. The fact that the changes are irreversible doesn't mean that the road ahead will be easy and without challenges. But I do think it is important to note, just as my American colleague did, that the possibility, the chances, the conditions for actually implementing reforms, for changing the country, has never been better than today. It is true that in some areas we would have expected more reforms, more progress after the Maidan. But at the same time, I do think that in some areas, some reform areas, I don't think the government gets enough credit for what they have actually achieved. I'm not going to go through all the different reform areas, but I want to highlight one of these reforms, which to my mind is probably the most important one during the last 1 year. And that is the decision taken earlier this spring to phase out the gas subsidies. It will be phased out by 2017. The government and the Rada decided to triple the gas prices. This is painful for the population, I realize that, but it needs also to be complemented with more support, social support to the most vulnerable people. But what's important is that this issue, every single president, every single government in Ukraine in modern times has known that it's madness to spend 8% of GDP on gas subsidies. It is madness to pay one of the highest prices in Europe for importing gas and then basically giving it away for free to consumers. It is bad for economy. It is bad for corruption. It's been one of the most important source of high-level corruption. And it is detrimental for what Sweden is very much involved in, and that is supporting energy efficiency. Ukraine utilizes more than 3 times more energy per GDP unit than the EU average. And Sweden has been very much involved. We've invested since 1995 more than 200 million euros in investing in energy efficiency. And I think the only way we can make tangible progress on improving energy efficiency is if there is an economic incentive to save energy. The cheapest gas is always the gas that you never consume. One last remark, and I think this is very much, very good, very well illustrated by the issue of gas subsidies. And that is, I think, the most difficult challenge, the most important challenge that lays before the government, the Rada, the president, the decision makers, is to explain what has been done in terms of reforms and why it has to be done. And I think the phasing out of the gas subsidies, the tripling of the gas price, very much illustrates that point. I understand it's painful for the people, but I'm convinced that for the economy, in order to create a more prosperous Ukraine, it's absolutely necessary. I think the challenge for the decision makers is to explain this to Ukrainian people. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you, Sweden. You were there for Ukraine in 1709, and you're here again. We really, really appreciate that. It took a little while, but I think we're finally getting there. Ambassador Tombinski, we'd like to ask you for your comments and remarks.
Thank you very much, Professor, and thank you all for the invitation to this conference and for organizing this venue. This is a springtime of conferences, but if I'm taken back 1 year ago to the mood of the conferences, we were in a completely different mood a year ago. This was sadness and sentiment of huge destruction, human losses, and tragedy. A year later, the tragedy is not gone because aggression is still targeting Ukraine. People are still dying in defending Ukraine's territorial integrity and sovereignty. But out of this tragedy, this is also a huge determination of forces. A huge determination of forces not to lose the other opportunity, this other opportunity that has been given to Ukraine, thanks to so many people's lives. This is a common responsibility of Ukrainians not to lose this opportunity, but also of all of us sitting here as your partners, because this, what happened here, was about basic values and principles of what we consider as democracies, free economies, and performing societies where human values are respected. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and thank you also, colleagues, Ambassador Pyatt and Ambassador von Beckerath, for all these comments. But allow me, as Ambassador von Beckerath started with this short argument with the name of the conference. You, Andreas, you asked to put an exclamation mark at the end. I have an argument with this labeling, post-Soviet legacy. We are more than 20 years since the Soviet Union is gone, and happily so in Europe. And we should not look for easy explanation for our bad deeds in the past. This was not about something that has been imposed by Soviet legacy. It was something that people did fail to address properly in the right time, to build a sustainable country with all institutions, structures, political and economical life as it should be. So this is not that something has been imposed from outside to Ukraine, but it has been also very much inherited to how the society and especially the leadership of the country has spoiled this possibility of performing better over the past 20 years. So I would rather call, let us escape from non-performing time of Ukraine, to get, as Andreas said, up and not down with how Ukraine performs. And what happens in Ukraine, and what is the situation of Ukraine, is not an exclusion for history. There are many countries. They went through different crises, including wars, civil wars, and there are different remedies. Well, we are sitting here on this side of the table, Ambassador of United States, Ambassador of Sweden, me representing 28 member states and institutions. We offer to Ukraine a combined treasure of experience how to go through the crisis. As people ask me to explain what the European Union is all about, I am puzzled because it would require a very long seminar. But I know one thing that I can immediately answer. This is a combined knowledge how to deal with crisis. So among 28, you have examples of crisis of every type. And this experience is now offered to Ukraine for making the country better performing. But one thing is crucial. The change will never come from outside. It requires Ukrainian ownership of everything what happens here and Ukrainian commitment, not only to declare, but to implement. To implement, 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 and to break the resistance of the so-called deep state. We see so many initiatives, so many ideas in certain areas, thanks to leadership of Ukrainian partners. There is a really dramatic change in how systems operate. Ms. Ontarieva tackled the question of banking system. You can't have an economy and a performing society without a banking system that performs properly, so you have to break certain structures. And we offer all the assistance for this process in order to navigate through this difficult process of changes with as limited number as possible, as less mistakes as possible. Mistakes are going to be done. This is always the case, but we have to have a courage to address all these issues and to see the goal. The goal, a sustainable, sovereign country, not that goes east or west, or Ukraine will stay where it is, but getting up and being stronger. One of the messages that should go with it is not only the ownership, but also trust yourself. You did this break last year. You performed over this year in dramatic circumstances in a way that helped Ukraine to survive this aggression and all the efforts to destabilize the country. So you have this huge trust. Now get ahead, get away from this turning into circle. The vectors are already given. One of the vectors, and this is the vectors that we are offering to Ukraine, is association with the European Union, not for the sake of being a part of a club, but of offering a set of rules that help other countries to perform much better, to be better than they were 20 years ago. Ambassador Pyatt made this comparison with Poland. I should not defend the colors of a country here, because I should speak on behalf of the European Union. But it does not pass a day in Ukraine that I'm not remembered about this experience of Poland and that Ukraine could perform better if it had decided to go this way 20 years ago. It requires leaders and the courage of leaders that they understand that they are only for transitory period, that they are here to prepare the future and to allow other leaders to emerge and take the relay and to bring country farther. There's also something that is so much inherent to democracy. We had this proof of democratic elections last year. We should prepare for elections in October in, I hope so, new constitutional set for the delegation of competences to local and regional levels, because this is the sense of liberating the responsibility and the potential of the country that is everywhere, that is not to be decided from the central point of the country, but to be tackled where the problems are defined and where people are close to those problems. But in this very sensitive process, and I guess the seminar will address the issue, some elements are of essence. The damage is there. The understanding that everything is repair is, I guess, now a common sense. However, the horizon that is presented with association, with other reforms, will only bring fruits in a certain period of time. So the big wisdom in politics is to go through the short period, so all the reforms with painful consequences, because it will require the society to absorb change, to adapt to the changes. I remember how difficult it was in Poland, that people had to adapt to a new currency, to new medical and health service, to new educational pattern, to new administrative setup. It goes not without a pain. But this is a wisdom of politics, how to show the courage, how to tackle the reforms, how to structure reforms in time in order to bring the country forward, and how to communicate short-term results. In a policy, short-term results will be here for the society to understand the direction where the country is heading at. Without this management of short-term results, the patience of society may be lost. So this is very important message for all of us, as well for us, forcing Ukrainian authorities to do more. As Andreas already said, that we feel somehow frustrated because of things that could have happened but did not happen. Nevertheless, we also have to understand that we have to create this critical mass of changes and the critical support for these changes in order not to gain some performance indicators in reforms while losing the society. This is something that we have to address all together, and this is also why Ukraine has such a massive financial and technical assistance in order to make it more digestible for the society. And thus used very much the pattern of irreversibility of changes. I'm a historian by formation, so I understand there is nothing about irreversibility of history, only time is irreversible. So this is not that we may declare irreversibility of the changes. This, what happened, requires everyday work. It requires everyday commitment, and on all levels of administration as of civil society. The society that we are so enthusiastic with, because this is the subject of everything what happened in Ukraine over the past period. But this society needs to have a structured dialogue with the political level and with administration. This is a responsibility also of state structure, to create the reliable, sustainable structure for a social dialogue in order to avoid third, fourth, fifth Maidans or other events that people are trying to psychologically impact on how Ukrainians act, but in order to create a workable transmission pattern from top to the bottom and from the bottom to the top, there should be a structured Ukrainian-Ukrainian dialogue from top to the bottom, but also across the country. And I don't tackle the issue of Donbass dialogue between Kiev and Donbass, because from my point of view, it is very misleading. You need a Ukrainian genuine dialogue across Volhynia, Zakarpattia, Odessa and Chernihiv, Donbass included, and Dniepropetrovsk, to create the sense of identity for the future, to create the sense of belonging together. This dialogue would help to create the main stabilizer for the country, the middle class, the conscient middle class that will come as the biggest, probably, asset of Ukraine if these reforms are carried out. This middle class that supported so much the Maidan could be the political escape from Soviet or post-Soviet legacy, if I take this title. So I hope that with this engagement of all of us, with your commitment to your country, with our assistance, with the international effort to stop the war against Ukraine, this change may be sustainable, and in 1 year from now, we will meet once again and to make a record of what has been done, what should be done, to talk about our frustration, but to have a sense that the country is moving in a direction and not moving in a circle. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador. We have a small surprise for you. I think we would like to hear the voice of a young Ukrainian and his vision of the future. And we held an essay, Vox Ukraine conducted this competition for an essay. And I would ask the winner of this competition, Timofey Stoshko, to come up and say his piece.
Добрий вечір. Як ви вже знаєте, мене звуть Тимофій. Я трошки хвилююсь такого рівня. Перший раз на заході такого рівня. Так, українською, напевно, розумію, що не всі розуміють, але я буду розмовляти українською, бо англійською не дуже. Так. Я студент заочного відділення Дніпропетровського національного університету імені Олеся Гончара. Кафедра політології. Чому політологія? Тому що мені завжди було цікаво, що коїться взагалі в нашій країні, чому ті чи інші моменти відбуваються, просто по-русски теж, так? В нашій політиці, з нашими політиками, тому я пішов навчатись на політолога. Якось сидів у Фейсбуці і побачив запрошення взяти участь у написанні есе на тему «Майбутнє України». Я вирішив спробувати і несподівано для себе переміг. Тому, якщо у вас є хвилинка уваги, я зараз вам тезисно розкажу про своє бачення, як я хотів би бачити нашу країну через 10-30 років. Я виділив три основних питання. Це економіка, внутрішня політика і зовнішня політика. Економіка. З огляду на третю наукову революцію, науково-технічну революцію, українська держава має зосередити свій розвиток у наступних галузях. Інформаційні технології, дослідження та освоєння космосу, розвиток альтернативних джерел енергії, технологія 3D-друку. Також не останню роль в економіці відіграє аграрний сектор. Кожен п'ятий громадянин України – підприємець. Завдяки тому, що рівень підприємництва зріс, Україна відійшла від практики експорту сировини і посіла лідируючі позиції у світовому експорті готової продукції та послуг. В українському експорті можна знайти майже все – від гвинтика до навколоземного супутника. З часом якість продукції та послуг українського виробництва стала відповідати світовим стандартам. В Україні було запущено масштабну програму будівництва автодоріг, яка допомогла об'єднати всі регіони країни та стала частиною глобального проєкту «Новий шовковий шлях». Також розвиток отримали і інші транспортні галузі – високошвидкісні потяги, авіасполучення, річкове та морське сполучення. Розвиток цих програм дозволив Україні більш ефективно використовувати свій економічний потенціал. Завдяки потужному розвитку економіки України, Україна увійшла до десятки найбільш розвинутих країн світу вже у 2030 році. Внутрішня політика – Було завершено розпочаті реформи у правоохоронній системі, медослуговуванні та армії. Українська поліція стала однією з найкращих на континенті, завдяки тому, що вона перетворилася з репресивного органу на орган, що стоїть на варті інтересів громадян. Українська армія створила нові підрозділи, які відповідають на загрози нового часу. Завдяки отриманому досвіду зведення гібридних воєн, військові з України стали бажаними гостями в будь-якій країні в якості спеціалістів. Українська армія входить до п'ятірки найсильніших у світі. Українська система охорони здоров'я досягла рівня ізраїльської та німецької. Громадяни України припинили виїжджати за кордон для лікування. Навпаки, вже до України їдуть медичні туристи. Також було реформовано освітню систему. Було впроваджено професійну освіту у старших класах загальноосвітніх шкіл. Тобто всі учні, які навчаються з українською системою, по закінченні школи вже мають професію. На базі кожного національного університету було створено потужні наукові та дослідницькі центри. Вища школа отримала більше самостійності. Корупція зникла з таких чутливих галузей, як правоохоронна система, освіта та охорона здоров'я. Наразі боротьба з корупцією за допомогою антикорупційного бюро триває на всіх рівнях влади – від президента до сільського голови. Завдяки створенню електронного уряду бюрократія здала свої позиції, і дозвільна система стала чи не однією з найефективніших у світі. Україна посідає одні з перших місць у рейтингах інформатизації суспільства. Вихід до інтернету доступний у кожному куточку країни. Всі більш-менш значущі державні послуги можна отримати за допомогою інтернету. Суспільство вільне. Кожен має право висловити свою думку, кожен має право на свою унікальність. Зовнішня політика. Україна отримала повну асоціацію з Європейським Союзом, стала повноправним членом Шенгенської зони. Але про повноцінне членство у ЄС у суспільстві точаться дискусії, хоча офіційне запрошення Україна отримала. Україна стала повноправним актором міжнародних відносин. За ініціативи України було порушено питання про реорганізацію ООН, оскільки ця організація не відповідає новітнім безпековим викликам. Нова міжнародна організація стала прообразом світового уряду, який має більш ефективних засобів для регулювання світових проблем та загроз. Україна – відкрита країна до всіх пропозицій щодо встановлення союзницьких відносин, але головними союзниками країни стають – країни колишнього соцтабору, США, Ізраїль, Великобританія, Бразилія, Японія, Сінгапур та Китай. Також Україна відновила рівноправні відносини з Росією після деокупації нею окремих районів Донбасу та Криму. Але ці відносини більш ніколи не стануть такими, як були до українсько-російської війни. Україна в рамках Східної, Центральної Європи та Балто-Чорноморського регіону створила Міжморський Союз, який мав на меті захищати інтереси країн, які увійшли до Союзу. До Союзу вийшли такі країни, що мають вихід до Чорного, Балтійського та Каспійського морів та Білорусь. З часом Міжморський Союз став вагомою силою в регіоні. Дякую.
Дякую, пане Тимофію. Я думаю, що ваше бачення майбутнього нас надихає. І ми будемо всі прагнути досягнути оцеї візії вашої. Дякую вам дуже. Thank you very much for your vision of the future, and we will all work hard to make it happen.
I think it's feasible.
Okay. And we have agreement here from North America and Europe that it's feasible.
Могу вам сказать, что не все, наверное. Я училась в советской школе, я училась в радянской школе. Она была профессией радиомонтажница. В наше время, в советское, это каждая школа имела с 8 по 10 класс обязательное профессиональное образование. Я не хочу в советское время, я не хочу быть радиомонтажницей.
Are you in the mood for some questions? Yeah? Okay. Here's your chance to ask the questions you always wanted to ask, and always afraid to.
Thank you very much, Vladimir Dubrovsky, Case Ukraine and Reanimation Package of Reform. I have a question to Mrs. Gontareva. I'm sure you heard from many times that the money is trust. So how, in which way are you going to restore trust in the Ukrainian banking system and in the hryvnia? I do not even mention the the evaluation, but I'm talking about the administrative restrictions that made the people that restricted the access to even current accounts of the people for 1 year and so on. I understand that you are doing a very important job in cleaning the banking system. It is absolutely necessary, but it is not sufficient to restore the trust in the banking system and the Ukrainian hryvnia. Thank you.
What we are doing, it's especially to restore the trust, because all these administrative measures, it's very temporary one. That's why we will easier, and after we will cancel these measures at all, when we stabilize the system and clean it up. It's the main idea how to restore the trust. Otherwise, you can pretend that business as usual, banks in the Soviet era, but unfortunately, nothing be there. Because it's absolutely clear that this banking system, from all these legacies, from previous time, from all these evils that happened recently, could not survive. That's why we're in a final stage of this cleanup exercise. And I already announced you that it will be, we suppose it's like a movie, Matrix Reload. It means that we clean up banking system after we announce that banking system already clean up. And after we start gradually cancel all these restrictions. And this way we will return, restore and return confidence and trust from the market, from people. I truly believe in this.
Thank you. Another question?
Thank you. Glib Vyshlinsky, GFK, Ukraine. Also the question to Valeria Gontreva. Valeria Alexeevna, let's imagine the following situation. For example, in June or July, Verkhovna Rada passes the law increasing minimum salary and minimum pension, for example, by 30% with constitutional majority. For example, President vetoes this law, but Rada overcomes this veto. And Prime Minister and President take political decisions that they should, Prime Minister should increase the salary and pension in line with the law and not allow arrears to accumulate. And Prime Minister and President call you and ask you to buy, for example, government bonds for 20, 30 billion hryvnias to finance increased budget deficit. What will be your answer to them? Thank you.
You know, last year was absolutely extreme year for all this so-called fiscal dominance. And we were asked numerous 100 times maybe to buy treasury bills, and finally we did some of that because of all these disbalances of Naftogaz, all this active war and no envisaged military expenditure in our budget. That's why we did all of that. But believe me, from now on, and also we agreed with Minister of Finance that budget deficit will not be financed by the National Bank. And that's why it's absolutely clear written in our EFF program. You can observe what the monetary aggregates we're supposed to have this year. And I suppose that in our program, unfortunately, or fortunately for our stabilization, but unfortunately for our people, not envisaged increase of pension and salaries for this year.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rost Lukac, Rotary, and also Reanimation Package of Reform. My question is to Mr. Yaronov Jeffrey Payet. In 1933, it seems, when the United States were broken by a depression, President Roosevelt signed the law about banking, and it named Regulation Q. So that says that loans, banking loans, should be not more than 3%, and loans 6% and deposits 3%, 3% and 6%, and seems it worked for 50 years, and it was very effective. Would you recommend this to your neighbor, to Madam Khontareva? Thank you.
Thanks. I'll just say two things. First of all, I mean, in terms of what reanimation package is doing, keep doing it. You and other civil society organizations are one of the reasons that my government continues to invest in democratic success here. I think on your specific question, it really isn't for me to say. And you know, the most important message that I think you heard from all three of us today, and Ambassador Tominski perhaps put it best, is this has to be a locally owned process of reform. It has to be transparent. It has to be undergirded by democratic practices. It can't belong to any one politician or any one individual, and it certainly can't be dictated from Brussels, Berlin, Washington, or Moscow. So I'm going to pass on the question itself, simply to note also that the extraordinarily difficult transformation that we went through in the 1930s occurred in a very different environment, and in an environment in some ways that was less challenging than the world that we all live in today, and the world in which Governor Hunter Reba has to work, because of course those were the days of paper ledgers and handwritten transactions, as opposed to the electronic herd, which Ukraine and the United States and everybody else lives with today.
Thank you. I don't know, I think it's maybe time for us to mingle a bit, to have a small reception, unless somebody has a very burning question, then we'll just become informal and chat with each other. Would that be fine? Well, thank you all very much for coming, and look forward to two more days.
Changed our manager.